สวัสดีครับ Greeting once again from Kasit Piromyai in Bangkok. This time I will give my views, comment a bit on the issue of military establishment's involvement in politics. Would there be changes for the better in the sense of putting the military establishment back into the barracks and allow the armored forces to do whatever they have to do in their profession? And having said this, I could not help but to recall the successful story of Japan, South Korea, and the Republic of China, Taiwan, for having been able to put the military back into the barracks. For Japan, at the end of the Second World War. For both South Korea and Taiwan, in the 1980s. And the three countries have become a very modernized, full-fledged democratic entities, second to none in terms of openness, accountability, transparency, and participation. The other two countries, as neighbors of Thailand, I could also express my admiration, namely the Philippines and the Republic of Indonesia. Up to about 30 years ago, they did have military intervention in politics. And for Indonesia in particular, one particular military family, the Suharto, presided over the lives and death of the Indonesian people for more than 32 years. But when the changes came in the 1990s to this present day, both the Philippines and Indonesia have been able to maintain the democratic structure and the democratic life in a very, quite a very stable, progressive manner. And one have to express the admiration and at the same time to offer heartfelt congratulations to the Filipinos and to the Indonesian people. But there are three countries in the area of the Asia Pacific whereby the military establishment or the armored forces are very much involved in the political life of their respective countries, directly, indirectly, or a combination of both direct and indirect intervention and dominance and so on. And I would like to take up the case of Pakistan for the fact that the military establishment, especially the army, has been the most powerful political entity in the country since its separation from India after the end of the British rule. The army of Pakistan has been very much involved in the political life of Pakistan. And lately, it has been supporting two political parties. Each of the party has a sort of a political dynasty to run over each one of them. But the army was not pleased with the other party led by the former world-renowned cricketer Imran Khan. They have, I think the army had maneuvered to remove him from power and work with the judicial bodies of Pakistan to come up with many of the trump-up charges, whereby he and his wife, Imran Khan, are being imprisoned at the moment. And during the elections time, the campaign and so on, Imran Khan was held in prison. But he was able to convey his messages and so on to the people, to rally the people, via the, I think, the modern information technology of AI and so on. So he was able to be, to keep in touch with the people at large. And the results of the recently held national election in Pakistan, his supporters, his candidates and so on, who had to run as independents because that party was being dissolved. But somehow collectively, all of these so-called independent candidates together under the leadership of Imran Khan came first in the election. How the government is going to be formed is for the Pakistan and the army to negotiate and for the international community to keep on observing. But what did the election reflect? It reflected that the younger generation had enough of dynasty politics, had enough of military intervention in politics. The younger generation of Pakistan wanted change for the better, wanted democracy to take a firm root in the life and affairs of Pakistan, and they wanted very, very much to see the army or the military establishment back into the barracks and do the military work and not to be involved anymore in the political life of the country Pakistan. Close by. But the whole point is that one is still in doubt whether the army has realized their shortcomings, whether the army has realized that they are not wanted in the political arena of Pakistan. But hopefully that they will have the sense and the sensibility to think about the reality and the fact that they cannot go against the trend and the will of the people that wanted to have Pakistan as a full-fledged democratic country. Next to Thailand, our neighbor, Myanmar, against the young people and the Myanmar people in general, 3.5 years ago, almost 3.5 years ago, went to the poll and voted for the NLD, the party under the leadership of Madam Aung San Suu Kyi. Overwhelmingly, they won the vote by, I think, 80%. The people rejected the army, the Burmese, Myanmar army-backed political party. It caused a lot of consternation, humiliation, and discontentment among the military leaders of Myanmar. And on the 1st of February, 3 years ago, they staged a coup d'etat. They prevented the parliament to hold its first session. So they more or less did away with parliamentary democratic entity life of the Myanmar Republic. But the coup d'etat has not been a success story, because immediately the people of all walks of life, of all ethnics, types and so on, have come out onto the street to oppose the military coup d'etat. And many have taken arms and have been fighting the Myanmar military establishment to this very day. And the democratic opposing forces are on the ascent. The Myanmar military establishment recently has been on the retreat And the thing that has been keeping them ongoing is the fact that they still have the air power, the jet aircraft, the bombers, and so on. And they still have been able to keep together intact. But how long? With so many defeats, with so many shocking defeats and humiliation and so on, whether the Myanmar military establishment can keep themselves intact. And at the same time, would they be able to come to the realization that they are an entity is out of place, out of time in the political life of the Myanmar people, that they are not wanted to be seen in the political arena. The Myanmar people in general, especially the youth and the young people, wanted to see a professional military that is not involved in the political life of the country. That remains to be seen. And the third country is my own country, the Kingdom of Thailand. The national elections held on the 14th of May last year had saw the result that reflected the wish and the aspiration of the younger generation of Thailand and the general middle class, that they have been, they are, or they were fed up with the nasty politics of political powers. They are fed up with the traditional way of participating in the political process through this patron-client system, you know, informal networking, and trying to amass wealth through political position and official positions and so on. They wanted at the same time to see the military or the armored forces of Thailand do the professional work, go back to the barracks, and no longer be involved in the political life of the Kingdom of Thailand. I think the struggle is still going on at this point in time. Most of the time, underneath the carpet, covertly, quietly, like a sort of a subterranean volcanic movement or tsunami. But I think the struggle is going on at this point in time. But why should we go into the conflict? If the military establishment of Thailand were to come to the realization that they are no longer needed in the Thai political life, and that their responsibility is to defend the country as soldiers, and they are not soldiers to have political role. That's for us to ponder, and that's for us to work together to send the message across to the Thai armed forces. Please go back to the barracks. Act like your Japanese friends, your South Korean and Taiwanese, Philippines and Indonesian counterparts. Be professional soldiers, but not professional politicians. Thank you very much. ขอบคุณมากครับ